Good morning, everybody, and a happy Sabbath to each and every one of you. As we enter into the presence of God, we ask that you stand as you have a word of prayer. Loving God, we thank you for this opportunity once again to be in your presence. Father, as we are about to start, we pray that you will come and be amongst us. Bless us and those who are on their way. Bring them here speedily. In the name of Jesus, amen. This morning, we want to start with that beautiful hymn. It says, praise ye the Lord, praise him in the height. Rejoice in his word, ye angels of light. Ye heavens, adore him by whom ye were made, and worship before him in brightness array. Hymn number 20. Continue the hymn 440. How cheering is the Christian hope.
Oh, it was us.
Sound says, sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Hymn 286.
Sabbath School members, both here and those who are joining us online. The psalm, Miss David, in Psalm 100 says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he who have made us and not we ourselves. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Aren't you glad that you're serving a God like this? God has been great. He has been good, better than good to us this week. He has allowed us to be found in his presence this Sabbath morning. What a beautiful day it is. We shall rejoice in this day and be glad that God has granted us the privilege of once more assembling in his presence to give him a note of honor and glory and thanksgiving and praise. So this morning, fellow Sabbath school members, let's stand and sing together the hymn number 468. And we are going to make a joyful noise unto God, even though we are but few in number.
Good morning, Sabbath School members. Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Psalms 139, verses 1 through to 10, and 23 and 24. O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my down-sitting and my uprising. Thou understandest my thoughts afar off. Thou compassionest my path and my lying down, and art acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid thy hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain unto it. Whether shall I go from thy spirit, or whether shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up in heaven, thou art there. If I make of my bed in hell, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thou hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. O dear God and ever-loving Father, we consider it a privilege this morning that you have allowed us to open our eyes and to give thee all the praise and the praise that thou deserve. We are sinful and insufficient, but you in your mercy, Lord, have attended to us. You have sheltered us during the week. You have clothed us. You have protected us from danger. Those are the ones that had to go to work and travel on the busy highways. I brought them again into your presence where we can lift up our voices and sing praises and hallelujahs to your holy name. For this we consider it a privilege because we can know that we can do nothing without you. It is in you that we live and we move and we have our being. And to this, Lord, we give you all the praise and the honor that is due to your matchless and holy name. We ask it in a special way that you will look upon us mercifully. Send your Holy Spirit to tabernacle with us. Where we have erred, Lord, forgive us. Where we have not done the things that you want us to do, forgive us. We put our all and our, we put ourselves at your throne this morning, asking for forgiveness. But we know that even before we ask, that you are such a merciful and loving God to us, that you have already forgiven us. And we want to claim that promise this morning. Thank you, Lord, for being the God that we can love and obey. Continue to be with us, Lord, in whatever we do and whatever we say. May all our praise and worship go to you, that it will not fall void. May it wash us, Lord, and clean our hearts, that may we make our petitions to you, that you will hear and answer. And may we have that confidence, Lord, to know that you are our God. You will never lead us wrong. And we claim that victory today. We ask that when you shall come and our time shall be no more, may we be found faithful. May we be in that number that John said, a number that he could not number. This is my humble prayer with thanksgiving in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, we have been taken to the throne room of Christ. All praise the Lord. This morning, I am in an encouraging mood. My little discourse this morning is all about encouragement. Encouragement for myself, and I hope that it will be encouragement for you. Now, I am going to be talking then about Jesus, the shepherd, who not only knows us, but loves us. Now, if I saw, or if you saw, a flock of sheep walking about, we only would see a flock of sheep, a herd of hoofs. We don't see a sheep. We just see the flock of sheep. All look alike to us. We don't notice any differences, do we? hardly ever. But not so with our good shepherd. Our good shepherd knows every one of his sheep. Are you a member of the flock, of his flock? Well, I am saying that God knows you. Jesus knows you individually. He knows everything about you. Every face is unique. Every story is different. Every sheep in his fold has a name. So when one goes missing, he knows. The songwriter said, that when the sheep went missing, Jesus, the good shepherd, went in search of that sheep because he didn't have to number them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 to recognize, okay, this one is missing. He can just look, and because he knows us so well, he recognizes when one of us is not there. Aren't you glad that you serve a God who is like that? The same thing can be said for a crowd of people. When you see a crowd of people assemble at a game, or you see them in the mall, do you look to see if it's Jack, Jill, Mary, whoever? No. Or you look and you see a whole big crowd of people, a herd of humans, a flock of faces. That's all you see. Not so with our good shepherd. To him, every face is different. Every face tells a story. Every face is a child, and every child has a name. He knows every one of us intimately. Psalm 139, the psalm that we had for our scripture reading this morning, is one of the most powerful and beautiful psalms ever written by King David. It talks about God's omnipotence, his all-knowing character. Through this magnificent psalm, we get a deeper understanding of the loving nature of our Heavenly Father. I want to challenge you this morning that if you have read that psalm several times already, when you get home today, read it over. And if you have never spent any time reading it, let today be the first day that you study that psalm and read it. And you will come to some of the conclusions that I have come to this week. I want to say that when you read that psalm, you come to the conclusion that God is especially interested in you. Say, God is especially interested in me. Oh Lord, he says, you have searched me and know me. The word search means to examine intimately. This carries the meaning that God takes special effort to search us and to know us. He doesn't look on the surface, but he goes down deep to the tiniest detail of our existence. He is not satisfied with merely knowing our name, but he wants to know intimately who we really are. And then you will also come to point number two. God, when God searches us, he knows everything about us. Nothing escapes his attention. He knows from the tiniest to the biggest details of our life. He says, oh Lord, you have searched me and know me. He says, you know my sitting down and my getting up. And even your thoughts, God knows, even before you think them yourself. Isn't that a wonderful God? Don't you feel encouraged to know that you are serving a God such as this? Notice the different words that God uses to show his great knowledge of us. He says he knows, he understands, he comprehends, and acquaints himself with everything that we are. Point number three, God's presence is everywhere. You have hedged me behind and before. And verse 7 to 10, when you read them, as so well as my sister read them this morning, you would understand that don't care where we go, don't care how much we run away, don't care where we think that we can hide, God is still there. God sees us, knows us, and he knows us intimately. Point number four, God knows us before we were even born. He is our creator, and as creator, he knows every detail of our bodies. Every heartbeat, God knows. Every cell in our bloodstream, God knows. Even the hairs of our head, he says, are numbered. Isn't that a mighty, all-powerful God? You are his child. As we sang in that hymn, I'm a child of the King, a child of the King. With Jesus, my Savior, I'm a child of a King. Look, isn't that sobering to think that this magnificent, all-powerful, omnipotent God values you as one of his children? And lastly, no, penultimately, God is especially concerned with us. He thinks about us. Jeremiah 29:11 says, I know the thoughts or the plans I have for you. Plans to do what with you? To do what? To prosper you and not harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Beautiful. My God has you in mind. He knows your name. He understands you. And the plans he has for you, plans to save you. Plans to give you hope and a future. And lastly, since God knows everything about us, then it follows that if we want to know something, we can ask our God because he knows everything. So anytime that we want to know something about ourselves, we can ask him because he knows. The psalm concludes then with a prayer. He says, search me, O God. Let me read it because I know it, but I don't want to stumble over it. He says, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me to life everlasting. David prays that God will search him, that he will exercise his great power on him. He prays that God will know his heart, his worries, his imaginations, his memory, his hopes, his dreams, his aspirations, his feelings, the plans, and everything else in between there. So, most importantly, David prayed for God to specifically show him his weaknesses. For by knowing where his weaknesses are, he has the full confidence that God can help him to become strong. And therefore, brothers, I want to leave that same thought with you. Recognize that God knows your name. Recognize that God not only knows your name, but he knows every intricate part of you. Recognize that he has specific plans for you, plans that would prosper you, not plans to harm you. So hold on to that unchanging God. Hold on. Hold on. Because if you hold on, you are sure that God will one day give you the desires of your heart, which I know that you want to live and reign with him in that earth made new. So I want to encourage you this morning, my fellow Sabbath school members. Believe that God has all your best interests at heart, and determine within your heart on a daily basis that you will allow him to work his way out in your heart. At this time, we shall be favored with a number from the screen. After which, we'll have our mission story.
I have a maker. He formed my heart before even time began. My life was in his hand. He knows my name. He sees each tear that falls and hears me when I call.
I have a Father, he calls me his own. He'll never leave.
Stephen N. Haskell was the first Seventh-day Adventist minister to visit Portugal. Haskell traveled around the world at the service of the General Conference. to scout the conditions for mission advancement. During this worldwide trip, he arrived in Portugal in July 1889. Adventist work didn't begin until September 26, 1904, with the arrival of the first missionary couple from the United States to Lisbon, Portugal. Clarence Emerson and Mary Haskell Renfro, along with their baby, were a young family with a passion to share the Adventist message. They began learning Portuguese, and soon after, they began selling Adventist literature, making missionary contacts and visits, and preaching. Since those humble beginnings, the Adventist Church in Portugal has grown to around 10,000 members. But with 10 million people in the country, the mission challenges are still evident. It is difficult to share the gospel in the growing cities. People are busy, distracted, and interested in things outside of Christianity. One of the ways Adventists have built meaningful connections in Portugal is through education. The Setúbal Adventist School opened in 1983. Lalita helped open the school and was its first teacher. She remembers how it started with only two students being taught in the church.
And so it was Fernando and Georgie who first attended school here in Setúbal. From there, other children came. Many children came. At the end of the first year, we had 28 children, and we continued. We were allowed to keep this open, and many more children came to attend the school.
They quickly outgrew the small church space, until eventually the building next door became available and they moved in. Parents noticed that this school had more to offer than just the standard curriculum found at other schools. Students' development of Christian values has attracted families to grow an interest in the Adventist Church over the years.
We look at the school as a center of influence. It's a center of influence that works with our children, but also with children who are not from our church, who even belong to other churches. And this is the great method of work of this school, influencing these children and their families who come to church for special occasions. Some attend church regularly. And we have several cases of young people who have joined the Pathfinder Club and eventually were baptized.
And that is why Pathfinders are exactly a complement to the church's educational project. Ultimately, they seek to educate for eternity. This church, at its base, clearly has a mission vision.
And what we have seen in these 40 years of work by this school in Setúbal is a very strong connection between what school life is and the life of the church.
We can transmit not only the knowledge of Jesus to children, but also to parents, guardians, who often attended church, and some children who ended up becoming Adventists, along with their parents.
This small school in Portugal has big potential. Unfortunately, the space isn't big enough for the school to continue to expand, and they have few resources. Staff, students, and their families pray for a new building that can accommodate this school's potential. This quarter, a portion of your 13 Sabbath offerings will help construct a new school building in a fast-growing area of the city. This will allow more families to be impacted by Adventist education.
I always pray for this school so that it can grow and develop. And who knows, one day we will be able to have a school with other, bigger, better facilities, with more conditions. And I think that is our objective. It's in my heart. This school is in my heart.
Please pray with Lalita for this project. Thank you for supporting the 13th Sabbath offering that will impact the lives of families in Portugal.
This time we are going to have our lesson study. I pray that as we study together today, that each one of us would indeed be drawn closer to God so that we can be counted worthy when he comes to live and reign with him. Brother Howe.
Good morning, everyone. All week we have been exposed to some very pertinent information regarding a topic that should engage our interest and attention, and which we should be keen to disseminate to those who need to understand that there is coming a time when the world will be in two classes, each pitted against the other. But pitted in what sense? Not going to war or to arms with one another, but their belief systems will be so contrastingly opposed that one set will try to make the others into what they are, while the others will be relying on God to help the one set see their mistake. That's the kind of scenario that this week's lesson paints for us. So I want you to be welcomed into the study and sharing of this topic, the seal of God and the mark of the beast, part. As you look at the memory text, I want to ask you a general question. What principle do you see in this text that is expressed another place in the writings of Paul? And the principle that is expressed in the writings of Paul begins with the word, this is the clue, whatsoever.
Good morning, happy Sabbath to everyone.
Yes, Don.
Yeah, the principle that we see here is that whatsoever man sows, so shall he reap.
Listen.
And the text talks about leading into captivity, that he will be leading into captivity.
It is so very clear. Paul says, whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. This verse is, he who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. And then, here is the patience and faith of the saints. Tell me, would you want to be able to exercise force to lead someone into believing what you believe? Did you say yes, Christina? Tell us why. The question is, would you want to be able to use force to lead someone into believing what you believe? Tell us why. Use the mic. Use the mic.
Human nature, I would like to be able, if it takes force or persuasion, so my mother would be an Adventist because it's what I believe. So I want her to believe, you know, we force our opinion upon her family or friends or colleagues. It's human nature.
Now, the qualifying point that you've made is critically important. It is human nature. And so I'm going to ask the congregation generally, wouldn't you want everybody in Barbados to be Seventh-day Adventists? How about if the government legislated that everyone must be? Why no, Joel? everyone has agreed that choice is so important that God respects the right of a person to choose to be wrong. Now that sounds interesting. God respects your right to choose to be wrong. God doesn't want you to choose to be wrong. But because he is so sold on the idea that you must have freedom to exercise choice, even though the consequences for bad choices are bad for you, he will not force you to choose different to what you choose. He will expose to you all the consequences, the benefits of choosing differently. But when you've made up your mind that that is what you will choose, he respects it. So this he who leads into captivity and kills with a sword is so determined to exercise human nature that it is prepared to take away people's freedom of choice because they choose to be different to what they want. We come to a word that may be new for some of us. The word is Waldenses. Who has never heard of the Waldenses until you've read Sabbath afternoon section? Is there anyone who has never heard of the Waldenses? Winston, you're one who have heard of the Waldenses. Your hand did not go up. Come tell us something about the Waldenses. What made them peculiar in the era in which they lived?
I don't quite remember, but I tell you, but I read it about them. And they were determined to stand up for what they believed.
Repeat that for me, please.
They were prepared to stand up for what they believe.
Thank you. Listen, if you are not determined to stand up for what you believe, you will be what is called a wishy-washy Christian. Somebody tell you something today, you go on with that. Tomorrow somebody tell you something different, you go on with that. You'll be on a seesaw. The Waldenses were a people determined to stay faithful to their understanding of the Bible. Seventh-day Adventists must be determined to stay faithful to their understanding of the Scriptures. And so in 1488, many Waldenses in the Valley of Lose were brutally murdered by the Roman Church. For what? Their faith. All because they would not believe something different. You remember I made the point that though we want everybody to be Seventh-day Adventists, we don't want it imposed by legislation. And the reason being is contrary to God to force people to do what they do not want to do. Similarly, we must be so determined to be steadfast to the Bible, that even when we come under persecution, persecution can be manifest in various forms. You know, when people lose their jobs or are threatened with loss of employment, that is a very simple form of persecution when it's for their faith. I remember in 1990, the cement plant had a vacancy that they could fill. Paying in 1990 a good salary. You know, $3,000 a month in 1990 was good money. In 1990. But they would have required that I work 2 Saturdays a month. Just 2. If I had come to church one and gone to work the next, You won't know if I went out visiting. I would have gone out visiting in truth, visiting at the devil's employ, because I would have left God. So the thing is, I didn't take it and couldn't take it upon conviction of my faith. The point I'm making is that except our minds are made up to be faithful despite the circumstances, we will bend and yield and be carried away with the great falling away that has taken place and is continuing to take place. Come again, Winston.
I have a similar experience. In 2007, I was doing some work at the Kensington Oval. Mm-hmm. I was on top of the highest building in Kensington, the 3W stand.
Right.
I was up there doing some welding up top there. Mm-hmm. And when it came to 4:30 that time, I called the crane man and told him, you need to get me down from the top here.
Right.
And he did come and took the welding plant and me down. But the authorities tell me, no man, you can go get somebody to come and continue. I tell him, no, I can't left the welding plant because it's part of me. I got to go, and that has to go. You understand? They were paying me good money.
Right.
But my principle was that the Bible, remember this, what the commandment says, your ox, your ass, and anything that is it. Right?
Right.
So I decided, look, they got to go. You see, people respect you for what you believe.
Right.
And I will tell you another story that while I was there, I had to do a whole lot of things for them. But when it came to Friday evening, I did enough, and I told them, look, you will not see me tomorrow. Probably the next thing you will see me is either Sunday or Monday. And I remember one of the leaders, he came to me and said, give me a knock, good man. I had to cut out some things out the earth. And these things were giving me hell, real trouble. Somebody had started, and it was giving them trouble. So then I continued. The first day I went, I decided I would have gotten these things done in one day, and I charged them X amount of money. But the next day, that Friday I went, and I could not get these things cut out. I got one cut out. I said, no, boy, this ain't right. I went back the Sunday and got out one. I said, no, this ain't right. I said, I know I'm not going back to Kensington. Monday morning, the guy called me, are you coming to Kensington? I said, nope. He said, what's your problem? I said, these things are giving me stress and money. He said, okay. Come down to Kensington. Let's talk. I went down to Kensington. And I got an audience with him. And we decided on a price. And when I decided that, well, yes, I got to have an idea of how we get these things. If anybody know anything about Kensington, when you're working at Kensington in the water, in the hole, water comes up all the time. Water's coming up all the time. And I had to get a pump to pump off. Then I had gone to the place, got the torch, sorted out. And when I finished, the man could not believe that I got it done. And so much so that he paid me for an extra one that I didn't do. He told me, look, write your receipt for that one. All because I stood up for a principle.
Precisely. So, standing up for principle in 1655 caused the death of more than 4,000 persons who would not yield their faith to the control of another. And these incidences and occurrences through history have always been instructive because they tell us that there is a class of persons who want to control the minds of other individuals that they will think like them, believe like them, do like them, even if they don't want to. That is really intention for slavery of the mind. When you do what I say because I say it and because the consequences are grave, though you don't want to do it, God doesn't work like that. God gives liberty, freedom of conscience, freedom of will. And since the outcomes are always tied to the inputs, then you choose what will be your lot. As controlling as this power had been, there arose a time when somebody was so fed up with it that they reacted violently. Who was the person that took the Roman power and gave it such a lash that its head was unseated? Name the individual. Nobody knows. It happened in the year 1798. A war was going on. Napoleon had a general, and he dared to venture into the Holy See. What was his name? General Berthier. Do you think it was by chance that he took the Pope captive in such an unceremonious way that the Pope died in exile? Do you think it was just by chance? Welcome back, Glendine. Elaborate on that, Argyle. You said no, so tell us why you said no. It was the fulfillment of prophecy. What exactly was the prophecy? You can tell me in a sentence. I'm not sending you to Daniel. The prophecy was that this power would receive a deadly wound. But notice, though the wound was deadly, it was not terminal, because it was able to survive. If the wound had been terminal, it would have been dead right through. But the wound was so deep and severe that it was comatose for a while. The institution, that is, the institution lost its head, the Pope. And Pope Pius VI, he lost control. The blow to the papacy was serious. But according to Revelation 13:12, the deadly wound would be healed. Come and see. And the world would hear more from this power.
Morning, everybody.
Good morning.
You had a point in history there that we need to recognize. You mentioned Berthier. Again, this morning want to concentrate on a system for just not one individual, but a number of organizations and groups. Because you remember, the Protestant movement came about as a result of individuals who withstood the beast and the power. So you had power and the seeking authority. And remember, when Pope Pius refused to give in to Berthier because he was asked to decease and hand over his authority to Napoleon, he refused, so he was arrested in 1798. You mentioned there the situation that the womb was healed. So we find during that time, we had the emerging United States of America, became land of free, Protestants ran over there, able to service God, worship God as they please over there. And thus we had this Protestant Reformation. Earlier, when you mentioned persecution of the Waldenses, that was on the real listeners that come to the road. Remember William Tyndale, the one who decided that the Bible should be in the hands of ordinary people, translated over 80% of the Bible, he was massacred as well. Because the devil knew, if we don't study the word, if we don't know the word, we're going at a great disadvantage.
Correct.
And this is the point you want to make this morning as well. But you just mentioned, Brother Hal, about the restoration of this deadly wound. In 1929, Rome got back its power as a political power, and a religious power. It was given back. What Berthier took from it, it was given back in 1929. And we saw the reemergence of this deadly wound again and the system. And note today, the Protestants who protested then are no longer protesting. This present Pope has told them, you protest, we no longer at war. We agree on these things, so let's hold hands now and go forward. No need to protest any longer. And so we see acquiescence and a coalition being formed again. The system, not only the papacy, because we tend to attack the papacy, but I'm saying it's a system of not only the organizations, and then governments coming on board as well, to give it its power. But one thing that it will never get is authority, because authority is God's. Simple power and authority. So as we see history evolve, we recognize that God's in the midst of it. And as you said earlier, we have to make a decision that stands, either be with God or against God.
That's right. Now, what's interesting as we peruse this lesson is that God had been telling the world through the scriptures from as far back as 600 BC in Daniel what would occur over time right down to the end of the world. What can make our faith concrete is the fact that as we look back, we see the exact fulfillment of the predictions made before the occurrence. So for sure, we know that God has knowledge of the future. God is able to tell what the events will be and the final outcome. And if God is able to tell us the final outcome, then our faith in God should be cemented, because he has predicted that his return will also take place. And if he could, before hundreds of years, centuries before the event, give the details of the event, clearly he is able to fulfill his promise. Now, Dallas Cummings mentioned the healing of the deadly wound when Mussolini helped the papacy to be again a state, have a seat at the United Nations, and influence world leaders. The Bible talks about the whole world wandering after the beast.
And you know that the beast has two aspects, the old world followed by the new world, because it's a continuation of one thing, Satan using humanity to fight against God's will. As we tread into Monday's section, under the title, The Fallen Away, would someone please tell me who it was that the Lord used to let everybody know that there would come a time when Christianity would stop displaying the attributes of Christ and instead exemplify the attributes of Satan? Who was it that the Lord used? Is my question too couched too difficultly? I'm only looking for a name.
It was Paul.
That's why I say who. Yes, it was Paul. Paul talked about Christianity becoming corrupt in this phrase of falling away. A falling away implies that there is a onward progressive movement from a place of nobility to a position of degradation. Remember, it didn't say climbing, it said falling. So you start high when you fall and end up low. And the Christian church, founded by Christ, started out as a pure church. But even in the time of Christ, there was an element that did not have Christian principles embedded in its constitution. Who was he? Abby, you want to hear that question? Who was he? When Christ formed the nucleus of the church, there was an element that did not have Christian principles embedded in his constitution. Pastor, you want to help them? Yes. Oh, everybody should know about him. Indeed, Jesus had 12, didn't he? And out of those 12, one, the Bible calls him a devil. Jesus says he was able to present 11, and the only one he lost was the son of perdition. One. Why did I say that that one element did not have Christian principles in his constitution? Tell them that. I'm repeating it for our benefit, for the others on the screen. Erica says in Beijing, he was too licorice. Listen, Beijing is good language. We understand one another. When you want to sell your leader, what do you call that? That has to be more than greed. Avarice, malice, some every kind of thing that bad in it. A man who has only done you good, who has only done everybody good, and it could swell up in your heart to sell him, to make a piece of money off of him. So he did not have Christian principles in his constitution, in himself. Because look what he stooped to do, to sell a man for a piece of money. And then on top of that, did he get to make any good use of the money? Couldn't live with himself. He went to commit suicide. I tell you, he ain't make good use of it. So from that early start, there was an element
that Satan had had the mastery over. Judas, because Satan had filled his heart. You understand? So that so when Paul talks about a falling away, we understand Paul is talking about a structural default, a structural fault in the Christian body of faith, in which it would degenerate from manifesting all the principles of Christ to embodying some principles that are synonymous with satanic philosophy. Satanic philosophy involves forcing people to do what they do not want to do. When the Christian church flexed its wings and saw that it had power, and the political power was behind it, it decided, you remember I asked you, if suppose we had everybody in the island to be said, well, they this. It decided, well, listen, you live here, you will be a Christian according to what we present. But the thing is, they had adopted pagan philosophies to win the confidence of the pagans and then impose that pagan philosophy on the whole world as if it had been Christianized. Force is one of the things that is synonymous with Satan's principle. To the extent that this power manifest through human institution would exalt itself above all that is called God. Didn't we read in the book of Ezekiel that Lucifer presented himself, his ambition and intention to be above God? So if a power is presenting itself as being super to God and taking the place of God, then clearly it has fallen away from the model that Christ has presented. Christ's model is that his church are to be servant leaders. Servant, he came to serve. This power decides not to serve, to be boss. And if you don't want to do what we say, then we will force you to do it. They are the lawless one of 2 Thessalonians 2. When we compare Daniel's prophecy of the blasphemer power that succeeds pagan Rome with John's word picture of the leopard-like beast, many similarities are revealed. The little horn, the beast power, and the lawless one. Clearly, we can conclude that Daniel, Paul, and John are speaking of the same entity. It is known collectively as the papacy. Come, Winston.
You know, earlier on, this same thing happened because remember that Daniel, a captive boy, in Babylon, and when Darius took over, he made Daniel
the boss,
prime minister. But he had made a decree because those who were around felt that Daniel should not be in charge of them, as it were, right? And he made a decree, and you know the king make a decree, his stamp goes on it. So he cannot be changed. And so it was that Daniel was not to pray to any other god. But Daniel not only prayed, but Daniel opened his windows so that everybody can see.
He's not hiding.
He's not hiding. He ain't making no bones about it. He's opening it openly so that others can see. And so they saw, and they went to the king, they went to Darius and told him. But you know, Darius had no choice because he could not go back on his word.
Right.
And he had to put Daniel in the lion's den. But he was so concerned for Daniel, he said that your God will deliver you. And so Daniel was in the lion's den. And early, that man could not sleep the night, because very early in the morning, he got up and went down there to see if Daniel's God, had protected him. Mm-hmm. Daniel's God did protect him, because Daniel went and said that my God closed the lion's mouth. Mm-hmm. So he had no problem. What I'm saying is that when we stand up for truth or stand up for God, God will stand up for us.
Correct. Well, while you're there, let's not overlook the element of deception that was involved in that plot.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Satan is a boss at deception.
Of course he is.
So, in getting the whole world to be aligned with the fallen away Christian church, he brought in a masterstroke of deception.
Yeah.
By aligning a day that does not represent God's creation as the replacement. And clearly, if it is the replacement, it can't be replacement for God. So, in essence, he was using that deceptive stroke as a move to get himself replaced as the one worthy of worship. The issue has always been about worship.
I never close this. Everybody says that. We got nothing to fear for the future.
Except you forget. So, I wouldn't go through the detail of Tuesday, but I want us to understand that at a time of great crisis, when the world is scared, hurting, and fearful, people will be desperate for someone to bring some stability and protection. There has always been a crisis of leadership. And Satan's answer to that is to put up someone who is eminent enough in the world's view as to be followed. Such a one is the head of an institution whose influence has reached so far that it has many daughters, and now it is even reaching to the ones who think that they don't belong. The Muslims, the Hindu. He is also gathering them into a world confederacy where the two classes will be those on God's side and those against. Come in, Chris.
So, morning, brother. I'm wondering if there's any specific response that we should have in light of this. So having sort of gone here time and time again and have these understandings that there is coming a time of crisis, a time when state and church will come together against us and so on, what do we do as a people? What sort of relationships are we supposed to form to combat this, to deal with this, to get through this, or whatever the case may be?
I want to answer your question directly by asking you to read Revelation 18 and verse 4.
Really?
Yes.
Revelation 18, 4. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not her plagues.
Good. That verse tells us what we are to do. We are to form strategic alliances with individuals that under the call of God, they will want to come out of that corrupt system and be part of God's people. You ask, what are we to do? Mm-hmm. We are to call them out. You're looking for a different answer.
Well, so am I looking for a different answer? Not really. I am just trying to see how that answer, so I was trying to find out, what do we do? I mean, there must be something for us to enhance our closeness to God, our spiritual lives, and so on. The feeling that we are talking about these principles again, and that in teaching them and preaching them, I think we sometimes amongst us, some people don't understand, and some people feel fearful about some of this stuff. So I'm just wondering if we don't need to lean more toward teaching our people how to live in these times and through these experiences, so that there's a connect between that which is supposed to happen and how we are supposed to live, how we are supposed to be connected above. Because, you know, I mentioned, I think, a couple of weeks ago when we began to go into this land and this series, that, when the king sent out for his guests and he got in the good and the bad, when he came in, the one thing that he was concerned about in the dining hall was the fellow that didn't have on a wedding garment. In other words, he was concerned with those who were not clothed in the righteousness of Christ. So I'm just trying to you get what I'm saying?
I get clearly what you're saying.
All right, so
I think where I am misunderstood is the fact that a person who has on the wedding garment is not going to keep it wet.
All right.
I have one question in response to you. So is there not a responsibility of leadership or of the church to kind of like push us into studying some more, understanding revelation and what it is and what will be our responsibility, so that when the time comes that we will be fit, we would understand what's happening, and therefore we will be prepared? Because I get the impression that a lot of people don't really understand this mark of the beast, seal of God, and all that. So we going along just happy and saying when the time comes, that will take care of that. But we have to... And we're seeing from this lesson that all now we have to be prepared. So therefore, those of us who can't read and understand and don't understand it too good, I think it's the responsibility of the leadership in the church to teach some more so that we understand and we are better able to be equipped to face the times when they come upon us.
Thank you. Now, Pastor, you've heard that call, and it's good that you're here so that you can ensure that the congregation is taught the book of Revelation. Just a second, Ben. Now, when I say to call, right? Listen, it's like this. If you do not call people, God's people, out of Babylon, they will end up being lost. You will be responsible for their being lost. If you do not feel confident in calling them, and that's why I'm careful in my use of words, calling them, because calling them does not necessarily mean you're going to stand up behind a microphone and delivering a sermon for half an hour. You can call them by acts of kindness. Because when you demonstrate through an act of kindness, something is going to be awakened in them. Why that boy don't treat me so? And you're going to have opportunity to lead them directly or indirectly. In other words, every facet of your life is to be one in which you are displaying, demonstrating the better way of life living in Jesus. Some of you will have an easier method of communicating that by practical means. Others may do it abstractly through the word and sermonizing and so on. But the call is for each one to call people out of confusion. The call, you cannot escape that. How you do it will be tailored to your particular circumstances, your particular capabilities, and your connection with Jesus. Granted, the leadership has a responsibility to expound, to teach, to clarify, but only you yourself can implement. In other words, if I get here all day and expound to you the rise of the papacy from 538, its fall in 1798, its plans for the future, how it's using this environmental thing that core something. Yeah, they're using that, right? Or such. Whenever done, except you take it for yourself. Cecil and Edwin. Oh, all right, come.
Okay, good morning, everyone. I want to speak on the correction. Chris asked the question, what should we be doing as a people to come together at this time? I'm saying, like, we can preach and we can teach, but Joseph Nelly sang a song saying we must live our religion every day. If we are doing the things that we are preaching and being taught, then when that time comes, we will already be cemented just like the wildness. Right? And stand up for what we believe in. And that is basically what we can do.
Okay. You know, standing for what you believe is not an overnight thing. It comes, your faith becomes cemented and stronger as you pass through minor trials and difficulties until you get greater and more difficult things. So when you are challenged with a job situation and you overcome it, your faith will progress. When you don't understand the passage and you ask someone to help you understand it, your knowledge will increase. But you can't be dormant and expect to be ready one day when great trouble breaks. Chris?
So the gist of what I was asking, if not saying, is that in presenting the theory, so to speak, of these matters surrounding the third angel. The third angel's message, if I understand correctly, is about, it's really about righteousness by faith. It's about how God saves us. Now, these matters relating to the end of time and so on are also a part of it. But often what I'm saying what often we are kind of a knowledge-based community. We focus heavily on knowing and understanding in some detail these scenes that are ahead and so on. But I think part of the challenge is that we have lagged behind in an understanding of how we connect with Christ in the midst of these scenes. And if you listen carefully on the ground, you would hear some distress. You'll hear some people who don't have a clear understanding of matters and are having some difficulty relating some of these things, putting some of these things together and seeing how it really relates to me living out my life as a Christian day to day and so on. I didn't come here prepared to articulate this point this morning, so pardon me if I'm not as clear as I would like to be, but I think there's a real challenge, and this challenge exists amongst many of our people. We're in a time in which our leaders have told us that doctrinal and biblical illiteracy is hampering our understanding, a lack of teaching on important truths and subjects and so on. And I feel that way, even though this has been a very interesting quarter in terms of Mark Finley's teaching here. He hasn't gone into the other side of this subject, and I think that is the side perhaps that will bring people a little closer to God in this time and take away some of the fear and the trembling and bring some joy.
Possibly. You have the final word.
Yeah, you want to get in there. Brother Don made the point clear, distinctly clear, what he wanted to speak on as well. Let me say in response to Chris that we have enough personnel here being led by the pastor to fulfill this mission. It's for us to do it. But I want to say too that you started the lesson by talking about choice, right? And interests, what interests people. There's some of us who have heard the 2300 days prophecy from the time you're a baby, you don't understand it now. There's some parts of it you don't understand it to this point in time, right? And I can include myself in that. There's some concepts that still boggle my mind. But I want to make this point. The question turns is imitation. You hinted at it, imitation. Why do you think that government spends so much time changing currencies? Because the individuals who are there to imitate currency. Do you and I know a fake dollar when you see it? Scarcely, unless the person did a very poor job. The time is coming, and even now, when this same Satan is going to try to imitate Christ, heal the sick, do miracles,
and
if it's possible, going to deceive the very elect. How would we not be deceived? How would we not be deceived by our understanding and our connection with Christ? That's why I said last week, now is the practice time. If we can't stand now, we have to stand then. So just very careful as we hear these things, right? Our connection with Christ, we've got to work on that. Work on that. And only Christ is the one who can save us and keep us through these things, not we ourselves.
I'm closing now, but I want to let you know that we cannot escape our personal responsibility. No one can prepare for you. Right? So it behooves everyone to do the best one can to be prepared. Get as much assistance as one can to be prepared. But at the same time, there has never been a boxer who fought a match and won without practice. Remember, there's a great test coming. It's over the Sabbath.
Thank you, Brother Greenwich. I hope that we will study God's word so that when the time of reckoning comes, so as we have fortified our mind with God's truth, we are going to be able to stand when the time of reckoning comes. So get busy and study God's word conscientiously so that you won't be deceived by all the things that will come upon us. Now, tomorrow is the world will be celebrating Father's Day, and we want as a church to pay special tribute to our fathers. We recognize that God wants us to see our fathers as someone to honor, because our fathers, our father, our earthly father, is symbolic of our heavenly father. And this morning, we talked about our heavenly father, and we recognize that our heavenly father knows everything about us and has great plans for us, plans most of all to save us when he does come. So today, let us be grateful to God for our fathers, because they teach us many things and we can learn many lessons from them. God gave us our fathers, and we honor and pay tribute to them. And we honor as we honor and pay tribute to our Heavenly Father. So, fathers, we want to wish you a beautiful day. Happy Father's Day, and may you endeavor by God's grace to be good examples to your children, and so that you will do what God expects you to do, using him as the example to rear your children in his fear and his admonition. To close our Sabbath school today, we are going to sing the hymn number 101. 101.
Please stand, everyone.
benediction, I just want to especially welcome back my girl, beautiful young lady. All smiles. We are so happy to have you back with us, Sister Kristen. We hope that you're staying with us. I know you are just in and out, but I hope that you enjoy your holiday and that when you go back, you will continue to prosper as you are in your school. God bless you, and we are glad to see you today. Let us pray. Father Heaven, we give you thanks for your mercies. We give you thanks for the blessings, dear Father, that you have bestowed upon us, having been found in your presence this morning. We thank you, Lord, for your words of admonition. We thank you, Father, for your lesson study. We pray, dear Father, that as we traverse this side of life, that we would endeavor by your grace to make study an integral part of our existence so that we might be, our minds might be fortified with your truth and we'll be able to stand in the time when that time of reckoning does come. We pray, dear Father, for your continued blessings as we continue to worship you today. Be with us as we celebrate your supper today. And may each one of us, having been here today, would really be blessed and be fortified, and we would purpose within our hearts that we would be saved when you do come, because we ask all these mercies in your matchless name with thanksgiving. Amen. Our Sabbath school now stands adjourned until next Sabbath morning.
And a good morning, happy Sabbath to each and every one of you. All righty, how was your week? Everybody had a good week? Ain't sound too good at all. Okay. All right. And for those who are joining us here online, we are so happy that you've decided to make Hillaby your home this morning. As we continue for our worship, we're going to turn our hymnals to the hymn 109. It says, Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt, yonder on Calvary Mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilt. Grace, grace, God's grace.
Sin and despair, I going to continue with the use of number 251. And it says, I serve a risen Savior. He is in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he is always there.
Says, Father, lead me day by day, ever in thine own sweet way. Teach me to be pure and true. Show me what I ought to do. Hymn 480.
Thanks for that beautiful singing. Happy Sabbath again. I'm just here. Just take a minute to thank the church for its support in a distribution on Thursday. On On behalf of the Community Service Department, I'm extremely grateful for the help that we receive in a distribution on Thursday. I want to especially thank these individuals, Mr. Kishel and Tyler, for the initiative in contacting companies first. And I must say that I must recognize today some companies that were on board with us and gave us some contributions: Rubisco, Pine Hill Dairy, Atlantic Marketing, Simplex, Western, and Sundale. These companies were on board with us and they shared some stuff to us to enhance the products that we had here on Thursday. I want to thank some individuals for the support and helping us to get it together. This is Judy and Heather and Annette and Lorraine, Winston, Grant Lee, Dawn, and others. Sister Job, not here, but she came and gave us a hand. I want to thank her and Erica for coming and giving us a hand as we got these things together for our donation. I want to thank our members who made contributions to the cause. I must say that Thursday was a bit overwhelming. The demand was great, and supply did not meet demand. As we go forward, because as we said, that we would try to do this at least once a quarter. So we're looking towards the month of September, just before school restarts. But I want to, again, thank you for your support and contributions. I'm grateful with all of my heart for our partnering. And I'm sure some of these companies will agree also to help us going forward. I'm very thankful for God for that. I want to suggest to us as members that what we want to do going forward is that we will collect stuff on a consistent basis and try to get the perishable items as near to the venue, to the event as possible. So we want to encourage us to keep bringing our stuff. We have a barrel downstairs. We'll keep collecting stuff from week to week, day to day, as the case might be. So when we come to this event, we have some stuff there. And I must say again that although I would say that the stuff was pretty adequate, it proved to be very inadequate because of the large crowds that came on Thursday. So we want to thank God for his blessings and for us as a church as we go forward to meet needs, because there are many needs up there. May God bless us, and thank you very much.
Good morning, church. Good morning to each and everyone. Happy to see you all here. I'm here for two purposes, to give you some brief announcements. Our services will continue as usual Wednesday night, and we'll be back on Sabbath. This afternoon, the Personal Ministries Department is having an open-air service. I'm told that it will be directly up the hill behind the church. So persons are asked to assemble here, and we will go up the hill directly behind the church to have this open-air session this evening. The time is 4:30. Brother Don, 4:30 this evening. And we are encouraging you to come back to be part of that as well. Now, as you know, during COVID, we were moved to do things differently. And we started to broadcast our services. Initially, we started using two old cameras, D330 S's that one was mine and one was Kyle's in terms of broadcasting. We had no camera to broadcast, but we used some ingenuity and we were able to broadcast those services. Since then, the church acquired a camera that allows for us to broadcast. The quality broadcast that you see when you go on YouTube, That is the result of the camera that was bought, which was a Canon XA45 at the time. My information is that it may not even exist now. You know how it is with technology? It moves on and moves on and moves on very quickly. And that is what we use, the one upstairs, for broadcasting. Very recently, in the last couple of weeks, Brother Ford was inquiring about helping us with another camera. And as you see this camera here on my left, he brought it back with him, and we are now using it for broadcast. Ideally, we would like to have at least another camera. This allows for the viewers to see the congregation. There was a concern about, especially in lesson study, when persons were going to the microphone, we could not see them. Now, this camera is, is it 180 or 360, Cole? 360, which means it can view all around. So apart from viewing the congregation, it can also be flipped to view up here as well. And Brother Ford, on behalf of the church, I'd like to thank you for your kind donation. And this time, we move into, you can see it on the screen, that is the one that Brother Ford brought, which is a Prizrail, and it, in terms of technical terms, it is a 3X camera, which means it has a zoom capacity to come in, sorry, not 3X, 30X. It can bring the picture closer and closer. In fact, it has 1.5 times the capacity of the one that we have upstairs, which I think is a 20X. So at this time, hello? Yes, Brother Ford. Well, I was not privy to that information, and as Brother Ford is clarifying, Dr. Noel Braffett, Ms. Vaughan, and Bentley Ford made contributions for the purchase of the camera. We also need some other equipment for the camera so that you won't see, you know, we don't like to see strings coming around. There's a transmitter which I was trying to get here, but you know which I have not been fortunate to get it here, that we can put the camera other places without having to use electricity or the wires, so it will be neatly placed and looking in order. But all that will come. But the function here, my purpose here this morning, along with the pastor that will accompany me, is to dedicate these two cameras, the one that you see on the screen there, which is the Prizrail 30X. It has a resolution of 1080, which is the, forgetting my camera terms, the resolution that will give you a very good picture. And again, I encourage you when you go home and to share with your other friends our services, because it's on YouTube, Hillaby Media, and you can watch the service all week long. You can advance it if you don't want to see everything. If you want to get to the preaching, if you want to see the Sabbath school study, it is there as an evangelistic tool as well. So let's continue to use the media to spread the gospel. So at this time, I'm going to call the pastor up so that he can give, yes, Brother Ford is rising again. Uh-huh. Okay, I can give you the information for the transmitter, because it not only will service this one, if you get multiple, it also services the one upstairs and any subsequent one we have. So the more prepared we are, the better. As good Boy Scouts, we must always be prepared. So at this time, I'm going to call the pastor here, and he's going to do a dedication prayer for the two pieces of equipment, whereby now we dedicate them to the service of the Lord. And as I said, let's use the medium we have to help to spread the good news of Jesus Christ.
Shall we bow our heads as we give God thanks? Gracious Father, our hearts are full of gratitude this morning as we bow in your presence. We thank you for life, for health and strength. But especially at this moment, we come to dedicate these two cameras that are being used in your service. We are thankful, Lord, for those who dedicated them, those who gave them. We ask your continued blessing upon them, because through these cameras, your ministry can go out to the world. And Lord, as we dedicate them before you, we ask that you would teach those who are to set them up to use them, to be delicate, to be as careful as possible that this material being used in your service would have long life. Again, we lift those who given them before you to ask that you will bless them in a special way. Continue to inspire their hearts, Lord, and help them to know that in their giving, that they have just contributed to the furtherance of your gospel. We pray for those who would hear the word through these cameras, who would see. We ask that the cameras will be used to minister to them, to draw them to you, to inspire them. Father, those who are coming to speak on your behalf and sing in whatever way the cameras will be used, that they will come totally dedicating themselves to you, that as their voices and their images go out to the world, that people will see you through them. So continue to be with us. We continue to give you thanks. We continue to ask your blessings in Jesus' name.
The clerk has some business to do in relation to a transfer, so I would invite Sister Joan to come at this moment to do that.
Good morning, church. Last Sabbath, we brought before you the names of two of our members, Brother Tremaine and Sister Shakola Vaughn, for transfer to the Amazing Grace Adventist Church. This is your second hearing. I'm voting, right, Pastor? I think so. Shakola Vaughn and Tremaine Vaughn.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I believe this is the second time that these names would be presented to you. Yeah. Okay, so now is the time when you get to play your part. These individuals are known to you, good and regular standing, I'm presuming. That's okay?
Yeah.
Right. So at this time, we want to ask the clerk to move that these names be transferred to Amazing Grace, and when it is seconded, then you'll be given the chance to. Yeah.
I so move that Tremaine and Shakola be transferred to the Amazing Grace Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Is there a second to the motion? Can we see? Seconded? Right. All in favor that these two names, Tremaine and
Shakola,
be transferred to the Amazing Grace Church, please show by the uplifting of your right hand. Thank you very much. It is carried. We ask God's blessing upon them as they move, that they continue in the service. Thank you. Thank you.
We're going to continue with the use of number 482. Father, lead me day by day, ever in thine own sweet way. Teach me to be pure and true. Show me what I ought to do. 482. Turn our hymnals to number 479. As we await the platform personnel, 479.
Church is called to worship. The counsel of the Lord standeth forever. The thoughts of his heart is to all generation. Psalm 33, verse 11.
Thank you, Heavenly Father, for this opportunity to bow in your presence. We pray that your Holy Spirit would stay near to us to encourage our hearts and draw us closer to you, that your name may be glorified and our hearts may be blessed. In Jesus' name.
Please be seated. Let me once again say good morning. Happy Sabbath to everyone. It is my privilege and joy this morning to be here and to welcome you to our service. Today we have our communion service, and I believe that we all will be blessed. And for those who are joining us online, I pray that you too will be blessed tremendously. It is also my privilege to welcome our friends and family back home. I want to welcome Sister Glendine. Good to have you back. And I also am very joyous of welcoming my daughter Kristen back here with us today. And as we worship, may we all worship in the beauty of holiness. So welcome one, welcome all. Our opening hymn is number 258, Baptize Us Anew. Chapter 14, and let's read together verses 12 to 16. Mark 14, 12 to 16, and we'll read together. And the first day of unleavened bread, when they killed the Passover, his disciples said unto him, Where wilt thou have we go and prepare that thou mayest eat the Passover? And he standeth forth, sendeth forth two of his disciples, and saith unto them, Go ye into the city, and there shall meet you a man bearing a pitcher of water, follow him. And wheresoever he shall go in, say ye to the good man of the house, The master saith, Where is the guest chamber, where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large
table. From the rest of the world all around, to a true weariness abound. May our lives be transformed by your love. May your souls be refreshed from above. As this moment that people now as we come to you in prayer.
Let us honor us to kneel at the congregation take a reverent position. Almighty and everlasting Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful privilege and joy to be in your presence on this beautiful Sabbath day. We have come, dear Lord, at your request, because you say unto us, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And Father, we come giving you thanks and praise and honor and glory to your matchless name. Forgive us for our sins, Lord. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Fill us with the Holy Spirit, that we may walk in the path of righteousness. We thank you for your Son, and for that great sacrifice he made for us, that we may have life and have it more abundantly. We pray, dear Lord, as we bow in your presence, that you will look on each individual. You know our situations, you know our challenges, you know our circumstance, and you will bless each of us according to your riches in glory. May we all be mindful of your goodness, your faithfulness, and your love and mercy towards us. We thank you, the Lord, for your word. And as your word is open to us, the Lord, we pray that our hearts will be open to receive, to obey, to follow in your way. Continue to bless us, dear Lord, as we go through this session. May our hearts be uplifted. May we draw ever closer to you, and may we all be eager, waiting for your second return. We ask you to be your spokesman, your pastor, Pastor Burgess, at this time, that you anoint him, dear Lord, with your Holy Spirit. Put your words in his mouth and your love in our hearts, and may we draw to you and to each other. Keep us faithful and save us when thou shalt come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. This is our offering time, and the video is played on the screen. You can come forward and put your offering in the receptacles up front.
Has been preaching since he was a boy and had great faith and mission for sharing the gospel. Therefore, he was invited to serve as a global mission pioneer in his country, Ethiopia. Excited about this new challenge, Berhanu soon realized that no Adventists were in the assigned area. Berhanu began inviting the locals to a Bible study, and soon enough, an Adventist group was meeting in a small rented building. Berhanu's love for singing has been instrumental in introducing Jesus to his new neighbors. After singing one of his favorite songs, Berhanu shares a heartfelt message that touches the hearts of many who attend his meeting. Most of these individuals work on government farms in the area, and the group provides them with a much-needed sense of community and friendship. Solomon was one of the people Berhanu met while he moved to this town to work on a farm. Solomon was feeling lonely, but after meeting Berhanu, they discovered that they were from the same village. After joining Berhanu's small group, Solomon feels like he has found a new family. In addition to regularly meeting with his group, Berhanu also walks 2 hours to meet with a group in another town. He is just one of 1,600 global mission pioneers around the world who are introducing people to Jesus. Returning your tithe and promise, which is your regular and systematic offering, is another way to work for Jesus. Every time you distribute your offering, as suggested by the combined offering plan, 50 to 60% of it will support the local missionary work of your church. 20 to 30% supports regional missionary endeavors supervised by your mission, conference, or union. And 20% will support the World Mission Fund, which, among other things, also provides for global mission projects. But in addition to your tithes and promise, you are impressed to walk a second mile and send an extra offering specifically to support global mission initiatives. You may access gm.adventistmission.org/giving and follow the instructions. As we serve Jesus through personal labor and our giving, let us emasculate Berhanu and put our desires last and God first.
Amen. Thank God for mission and missionaries. At this time, we have our children's story.
So part of God's story is about Jesus wanting us to know how much God loves us. Sometimes Jesus taught by using parables. A parable is a pretend story that teaches us a lesson. Jesus once told a parable about two brothers and a dad, and it begins like this. This dad had two sons. We call one the older son because he's, well, older. We call the other the prodigal son because he liked to waste money buying things he didn't need. One day, the prodigal son went to his dad and said, "Dad, give me my share of your money." See, he knew when his dad died, he and his brother would split the money. But he didn't want to wait for his dad to get old and sick and die. He wanted money now. You might think most dads would say, "No way!" But his dad actually gave it to him. Kids, remember, this is a parable. I wouldn't try that at home. Anyway, the son took the money and ran away. We don't even know if he said goodbye. And for a while, he bought everything he wanted. He bought stuff for his friends, too. He had so much fun spending money that he never bothered to earn any. Soon, he had nothing left. So now he needed a job to buy food. Problem is, the only job he could find was working for a farmer, feeding pigs. You know, animals that enjoy snorting and rolling around in the blood. And to make matters worse, his friends stopped liking him since he stopped buying them things. Although people who hang around just because you're buying them things are not real friends. Here was the prodigal son, stuck feeding pigs. No friends, no home, and no food. He was so hungry, he wanted to eat the smelly, soggy pig food. He felt pretty sorry he had run away. Have you ever done something and felt sorry about it later? It's not fun to feel that way, is it? Well, one day, the prodigal son remembered how the people who worked for his dad had lots of food to eat. He didn't think his dad would want him back as a son, but maybe he could be a servant in his dad's house. But this idea was risky. He had been so mean to his dad. He had taken money and run away. He'd spent every penny. He had acted like he never wanted to see his dad again. The prodigal son knew he didn't deserve to go home. But if he didn't ask his dad for a new job, he could die. So he decided to go back to his dad's house. Well, while the prodigal son was still pretty far away, his father saw him coming. And guess what? His dad started running to him. Then he hugged his son and even kissed him. Really, the Bible says that. In fact, he threw the prodigal son a huge welcome home party and even gave him special gifts. Meanwhile, the older brother was out in the fields, working. Kids, remember, this brother had been home the whole time, obeying his dad while his younger brother ran away. So when the older brother found out his dad was throwing a party for his younger brother, he was mad. Really mad. He had never gotten a party. He thought his little brother deserved punishment, not a welcome home celebration. Jesus told this story because sometimes we act like the prodigal son. We do things that make God sad, like how the son took his dad's money and ran away. Other times, we act like the older son. We follow God's rules, but forget how special it is to obey Him. Maybe we even want people who disobey to get punished, instead of being excited when they decide to follow God. But Jesus wants us to know that no matter what we do, He loves us. Just like that father. And that's the story of the prodigal son. So, in case you missed it, here's the quick version. There were two brothers. One loved buying stuff. He asked his dad for money. He ran away. He spent the money. He felt sorry. He went back home. His dad threw him a party. The older brother got mad. The dad loved both sons. And no matter what, God loves us too. And that's a part of God's story.
Amen. I love those stories. All right, we will continue the service by singing number 255, I Cannot Tell Why. 255.
Stand, everyone.
I'm
Praise the Lord. Please be seated. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Trust you had a good week so far. God has been good to you. God is good to us. Amen? Wonderful. Today we have another privilege and opportunity to uplift and praise and glorify Him. It is a Sabbath day. And He told us, 6 days shalt thou labor. The seventh day is the Sabbath. So we are here today to worship, yes, praise, glorify. God always has a blessing in store for us when we come together. Amen? There's a blessing that you get when you come to assemble with your brethren, that even though you're faithful at home or elsewhere, you're not necessarily received. And I say that God is good. Amen? All right. So today I want to share with you for the next few moments some thoughts that I hope will serve to stir us up, draw us closer to Christ. Let's bow our heads. Gracious Father, we thank you for another privilege and opportunity to open and peruse your word. And we continue to ask that your Holy Spirit would continue to draw closer to us as He inspired the writers of the Bible. May our hearts be inspired today that we can understand and challenge our hearts as we understand that we want to practice the things that we learn because we want to be better Christians for you. We thank you and we ask these mercies in Jesus' name. Amen. I've noticed over the last few months since I came to St. Andrew that my jacket is getting smaller. You know? I don't feel that if I put on any size, but the coat seemed to have gotten smaller. So I am attributing it to the good treatment in St. Andrew. I don't know if you want to agree with me, but I praise the Lord. Amen. This jacket used to fit. It's the last suit that I acquired. It used to fit so nice, but, you know, getting the jacket is getting closer now, so I may have to take it back and get it extended a little. Oh, somebody said the fresh air, but I maybe the good food too. You never know. But God is good, isn't He? And we should give Him thanks all the time. Amen. Today I want to share with you from our text, the text that we read, Mark 14, 12 to 16. Prepare. Do you see that word prepare used 2, maybe 3 times in the text? They were supposed to prepare for the Passover. Prepare. And there are a number of things that I want to show you that they were prepared. But one, when they were not prepared. And I hope that we can draw some lessons. You know, whenever the Word of God is open, whenever we read, God has something that He wants to share with us. Mark chapter 14, 12 to 16. Because Mark's account here, this account of the Last Supper, reveals some important points. About 5 of them that I want to share briefly. First of all, we discover that a lamb was prepared. Luke 22 and verse 8, Jesus Himself calls the name of Peter. It says that He sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare the Passover for us that we may eat." So you see that the Passover lamb was prepared, huh? And of course, Passover reminded the Jews of their deliverance from Egypt 15 centuries earlier. It also hinted of the one who would die for them as the Lamb of God. John chapter 1 and verse 29. John declared, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." So you see that
a lamb was prepared. Passover lamb was prepared, and Jesus was with them, who at that time would represent the lamb that was going to come. What that Passover lamb represented was actually with them there, the lamb who takes away the sin of the world. Secondly, Mark 14 and verse 13 tells us that the disciples met a man who was prepared to do his duty. And he sent out two of his disciples, and said to them, "Go into the city, and a man will meet you carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him." So next we see that there was a man who was prepared to do his duty. This man was carrying a water pot. Now, there were thousands of people who live in that city. And at the Passover, there were several thousands who also came in. So Jesus was telling them, look for this one man. Among the whole throng, there was one man who was the first to stand out. He was carrying a water pot. Now, in that day, this was the task of a woman. You wouldn't see a man carrying a water pot. But this man was willing to do it. He was prepared to do whatever he had to do. The next thing was, there was a homeowner who was prepared for the Passover. Now, we don't know his name. Some folk have suggested it could have been Nicodemus, could have been Joseph of Arimathea, it could have been the father of John Mark, but the Bible doesn't say. We don't know. We see from what is there that this person had to be a wealthy person, because only a wealthy person could afford, you know, a large house with a large upper room. It appears that he knew Jesus also. So whatever was his also belonged to Jesus. So yes, we have met and we discovered that a lamb was prepared. The disciples met a man who was prepared to do his duty. And now we see that a homeowner was prepared. The fourth thing we notice is that a room was prepared. Mark chapter 14 and verse 15. The Bible tells us, "Then he will show you a large upper room, furnished and prepared. There, make ready for us." It says he will show you a large room. It is furnished, it is prepared. Now, we were told that most houses in that particular place were small. The disciples were supposed to look and discover a large room. John chapter 20 and verse 19, we believe this is the same room where the disciples gathered after the crucifixion. They barred the doors, and the text tells us there it was for fear of the Jews. Despite what some others will want to tell us that they were worshiping, no, the Bible says for fear of the Jews. We believe it is also the large room that they used on the day of Pentecost. It sheltered its occupants from greedy merchants and the noisy masses on the crowded streets below. So yes, the land was prepared. This man was prepared. The homeowner was prepared. The room was prepared. But unlike everything else, the disciples were not prepared. Now, how could you make such a statement? Everything else was prepared, except the disciples. On this special and sacred occasion, everything else was prepared, except Jesus' closest followers. Everything else. And we can discover a few things that will bring us to that conclusion. Normally, under such circumstances,
a servant would have washed the feet of those assembled. We have learned that. Jesus arranged things, however, that the disciples would have the opportunity to act as servants. But they were not ready. Huh? They were not prepared. And so Jesus washed their feet. They needed humble unity. They needed their hearts cleansed from sin. They needed reconciliation with one another and with God. Jesus washed their feet in order to bring all of these things about. But Luke chapter 22 and verse 24 tell us one of the things that we can see that they were not ready. Luke 22 and verse 24. There was also a strife among them. Which of them should be accounted the greatest? This is what was bothering them. That's why they were not ready. Who was going to be the prime minister and who was going to be the president? Who was going to be the treasurer, the accountant? This is what they were concerned with. When Jesus sets up his kingdom, when he defeats the Romans and he is ruling, who is going to be at his right side and who is going to be at his left? So they were not ready. Everything else was ready. Ladies and gentlemen, what this service today represents. In Christ's death, we are all reconciled. Amen? We all have the opportunity. Christ does not force anyone, but everyone has ample and equal opportunity. This is the message of the entire communion service. The bread and wine symbolize our reconciliation to God. The foot washing depicts our reconciliation to each other. Our unity, our oneness. That's why we celebrate the communion service. In Desire of Ages, Sister White says, the ordinance preceding the Lord's Supper is to clear away misunderstandings, to bring man out of his selfishness, down from his stilts of self-exaltation, to humility of heart that will lead him to serve his brother. Servant of the Lord said that. The holy watcher from heaven is present at this season to make it one of soul searching, of conviction of sin, and of the blessed assurance of sins forgiven. Page 650, Desire of Ages. This is what the servant of the Lord is saying. So it makes us wonder why, when the communion service is announced and called, that some people just decide they are going to stay home. If the service is all about this, then why? I'm suggesting that folk don't understand. They don't have a true concept of what this service today is all about. When Jesus instituted the Passover, they reenacting that when they were freed, when the Israelites were freed from Egypt, God told Moses, when this particular one happens now, Pharaoh is going to let you go. I am going to pass over. And I'm going to strike the firstborn of every house in Egypt, from Pharaoh down to the beast in the stall. But he told them, you put the blood over the lentils. You put it over the doorpost. And when I see the blood, Exodus chapter 12 and verse 13, when I see the blood, I will pass over. So today God wants you and I. We don't have to go and kill a lamb like they did back there. Jesus, the Lamb of God, John chapter 1, verse 29, that takes away the sin of the world. He has come. He did it at Calvary. Now you and I must accept what he did back there by faith. Matthew chapter 26, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, we are told, as often as you do it in remembrance of me. So that's why we are here today. It is not convenient for us as a church to do this every week. So we do it once in a quarter. And I look forward to that time when we can come together. And symbolically, by faith, we are enacting, you know, we accept the bread and the wine. Not like some people who believe that when they take the bread, that it turns into the body of Christ. Or when they drink the blood, it turns into Christ's blood. We don't believe that. But we believe that what these symbols represent, which is the body and the blood of Christ, still has that power to cleanse us from our sins. That old song that we love to sing, the blood that Jesus shed, you know that song? Never, never loses its power. It reaches to the highest mountain, it reaches to the lowest valley. That blood never loses its power. And that's why we come to celebrate the communion service. In remembrance, to bring us, this service points us back to what Jesus did at Calvary. It points us back to the freeing of the Israelites from Egypt. It reminds us that right now, that Jesus is the one who sustains us. And in Matthew 26, we are told that you should do it in remembrance of me. It points us forward because he said, I will not drink of the wine of this cup until such time as I drink with you in the kingdom. So it also points us forward. So it gives us hope. That hope is building up within us. So when you meet your friends who usually shy away from the service, let me remind them as to why we come to celebrate the communion service. Let them know of the joys that they are missing. To build up within us the hope that points us forward to Jesus' coming. Amen? I would say that God is good. God is a wonderful God. His desire is to save us. Luke chapter 19, verse 10. He says, the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. And this reminds us today of what Christ did at Calvary. And it points us forward to what he will do in the kingdom when he comes again. Don't you want to be there? So I encourage you today that when you eat the bread and when you drink the wine, do it in faith. If there's somebody here that you need to make things right with, do it. If there's something that is between you and God that only two of you know, take a little moment and ask God to make things right with you. That's what God expects of us. And today is a wonderful day for us to do just that. Reconciliation. God wants for each one of us to make things right. Because his desire, and he said in Ezekiel, Peter also said it, God has no pleasure in the death of the wicked. His desire is that all men should be saved. That is his desire. So when he went to Calvary and he shed his blood, it was not only for the rich or for the educated. No, his blood was shed at Calvary for everyone. John chapter 3 and verse 16, that's what? That whosoever. And today we have a wonderful opportunity to celebrate, to remind us, give us confidence that God's desire is still to save us all. I trust that as we move to the next part of the service, as we celebrate by partaking of the emblems, that each of us would whisper a prayer, ask God to bring to our minds the true significance as to why we are here today. And help us that as we partake, that we will do so worthily. That if we have to go aside and ask, that we would do that. So that when we come to the table, that we would do so worthily. I pray God's blessings upon you as we continue in this service today. I want to encourage that we sing 317. King of my life, I crown thee now, thine shall the glory be. Lest I forget thy thorn-crowned brow, lead me to Calvary.
We are going to sing this song, and then we are going to move into the other part of the service. 317. 317.
As you'll observe, we have not yet resumed every aspect of the communion service, which involves the foot washing, but hopefully we'll get there the next time. At this time, I'm reading the scripture reading for the bread followed by the prayer, and then we will have for the wine. And thereafter, you will come up on one side. One side. And go down on the other side. So, Sister Erica will give you the coordination for our coming up, but you'll come this side and go down on my right. Matthew 26 and verse 26 says, "And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.'" Let's assume a position of reverence as we ask God's blessing on the emblems representing his broken body. Adorable Father, today we come into your presence acknowledging that we are sinners. It is a strange thing for individuals to love the unlovely, but it is your nature to love sinners, though you are holy. You want us through that love to recognize your great desire for us and to abandon our unholy ways and to become holy like you. You are so wonderful that you have not left it up for ourselves as to find out how we can do it, but you have provided the way, the truth, and the life, and the person of Jesus, who by faith, our acceptance of him transforms us into the holy beings you would have us to be. Today we ask that you would impart your holiness, your righteousness, impute the same also, Lord, so that our lives would be in your assessment as worthy to receive these emblems because we would have received your holiness. And thus our lives are transformed. Today we ask that having forgiven our sins, we would demonstrate our willingness to be cooperative with you in living holy lives, that others may recognize the high and holy calling to which you have called us, and they would desire the ultimate salvation, victory at last, in the earth made new, with eternal life, the crowning act for which your sacrifice was made. So be pleased to bless the emblem of our bread today, Lord, and let the bread of life fill our lives with nourishment and sustenance, so that in blessing this bread, you would bless us physically, spiritually, emotionally, and in every aspect of our being, that going forth from this place today, the evidence would be that Jesus is now the occupant of our lives. To this end, we pray in Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen.
And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." For this I say, my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. Amen. Let us pray for the wine. What can wash away our sins? It is nothing but the blood of Jesus. And we want to thank you, dear God, for your blood which was shed on the cross of Calvary for our sins. You died that we might live. And Father, I pray this day that as we celebrate the blood, the wine, which is symbolic of your blood, I pray that we will do it with all diligence, recognizing that you died that we might live. You died to save us from our sins. And I pray day by day, as we live, we will live our lives in accordance with your divine plan. Continue to be with us. Bless us today as we do this service. And may our lives be a testament day by day to others, so that as they see us, that we will live to glorify your name. Continue to be with us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come right up this way.
We have had a blessing to bread and the wine. Now you are free to partake. We are still in the mood where we come forward and collect. So please. Who will be first? Yeah. In the meantime, you can play some songs that are appropriate. 302, 312. Now you hold in your hand package containing a piece of unleavened bread. I say all the time, you know, like I mentioned in the message, what you hold in your hand, when you consume it, you won't get any high. It's not designed to make you feel anything superior. It is simply a piece of unleavened bread. We eat it in faith, believing that as it represents the broken body of Christ, that he still has that power to save us from our sins today. Has everyone been served? Everybody has been served. Amen. What Jesus did at Calvary was done for every human being who lived before him and who lived after, each one of us. Nobody must be left out from the table today. Amen? It has been blessed. Eat in faith, all of it. Jesus also took the cup and he blessed it and he told them to drink. We read the text. This blood, he said, was my blood. We have asked God's blessings upon the wine. And so I invite you at this time. Everyone has been served in faith. Yes, let's drink together in faith. Let's sing number 294. Power in the blood. want to pause at this time and allow one, two persons to share in the testimony. Since I'm holding the microphone, I will go first. Now, it's the month of June, right? The best month of the year. If I live to see next week's Sabbath, I will reach the ripe old age of 65. So I may not be with you too long after that. So I am thankful if I reach it, because we don't know what will happen between now and then. God is good, amen? But June reminds me starkly of something that happened in 2012. I remember on a Tuesday night, it was about the 19th of the month, I was sitting before the church, conducting the church board. And suddenly my head got giddy. I wasn't able to speak. You know, the words weren't coming. Things were happening. I had a stroke. It was kind of serious too. I was blessed that the 14 persons who were there, three of them were retired nurses. One was an ambulance driver. He had not retired yet. He's retired now. Charles Legall, he was driving the ambulance. And Deanne Sober, she was the head of the NAD at the time. So they saw I was facing them. They knew what was happening because of the signs they were seeing. And they rushed me to the hospital. My entire left side was paralyzed. No movement, whatever. Face was twisted. But God is good, isn't he? Amen. Amen. I remember somewhere in between there, I spent about 5 days in hospital. And Pastor McKellen was the ministerial secretary. And I was told, my wife told me afterwards, that one day I probably was dozing, because when you have the stroke, it interferes with the brain. So you can hear now, and then next minute you're dozing off. But she told me that he came to the ward and he tickled the bottom of my left foot. And when he did that, I just jumped. And apparently from that time, I just regained the use of my left side. And over time, you know, I came back to myself. I remember the doctor, the consultant, after I was released, I used to go to him for appointments. And one day he put up his laptop and he showed me. He told me, that is the spot there on your brain where the stroke was. He says, you really shouldn't be sitting before me now as you are. If you were not dead, you should not be walking. The size of what he saw there, that's what he told me. But I was walking. I'm still walking today. God is wonderful, isn't he? So I give God thanks and give him praise. That when it happened there, that there were people who knew what was happening. One, I remember while it was happening, somebody said, take off his shoes. Somebody else says, don't let him drink any water, because I always have a bottle of water. Don't let him drink any water. Don't let him fall down. And then I don't remember anything else after that. I just remember waking up in the hospital. So I am giving God thanks today that he has brought me through 2012, you know, 10 years, 11 years. And God is good all the time. So I'm thankful. I don't know what tomorrow may bring. You don't know if I will reach 65. I'm looking forward to it, but you don't know. So in everything, we need to give God thanks. So I praise him today. I want you to join with me in praising him. Pray for me. Let us pray for each other as we look forward to Jesus' coming. Amen? Somebody else want to share in the testimony?
Yeah. So I can join you, Pastor, as a fellow June birth. Today is actually my birthday, so it's my 30th birthday. So I just want to give God all the praise and the honor for allowing me to reach this milestone, because many persons, I have colleagues who haven't been able to reach this milestone of 30. So I am honored to be celebrating my birthday on the Sabbath day and also today's communion. So that's a great honor. So all praises to God. Thank you.
It's good. I'm sure that he has brought you through something, some experience. Is there one more? Okay. cat goes down, mate.
Thank you. There's so much to give God thanks for. And I give God for all his goodness and mercy towards my life. So much things happened to me in the past. Even when I lived to see my birthday last year, I was okay. But after that, things started getting down with my health. I see signs, but I didn't really pay any mind. But thank God for Hillaby Church that at the right time I was here, that God come through for me to allow me to stay back. Thank God for me and Heather that was there to encourage me that we would stay. And the report was not good at all. And thank God for the journey because I could not go through it alone. Thank God for the people that prayed for me that day. And thank God for allowing me to show me, despite I'm going through darkness, that he will bring me through marvelous light. And I see that when he was said that we need to go to the doctor the same day, but by faith we stand up and say we're going to meet heaven, we decided that we can go on Monday. When the doctor see me, it's like when he's, if I come 2 days late, I will be late. I will be gone. But thank God I'm alive, and I give God thanks. The journey is trying my hands. The sand here is difficult sometimes to undo a bottle or anything. Sometimes to comb my hair is difficult, but I can still do my work. I realized that the saucepan and the things was dropping out of my hands, but I was still going to work, and I give God time for his blessing. I know this journey, I would have gone, but I'm here to testify that if you're ready, when you're ready, God will take it, but it's a time to show you that don't matter what we go through, God is with us, and he don't put no more upon me able to bear. Thank you for the church family that helped me through my trials and situation, and I give God the thanks and praise that God is still God, and he's an awesome God. Amen. And he never late, he always on time. Thank you.
Amen.
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 Right behind.
Good afternoon. I thank God that I am here today because year before I had a stroke as well. But I went to the doctor and he told me it was vertigo. He gave me an injection the same time I walked into him. I went down there, then I walked into him and he gave me an injection and tell me it's vertigo. He tell me that injection will help me. Well, I would say it helped me down. Cause I walk into him, and when I ready to get up from there, he had to bring a wheelchair for me to get up. And I didn't walk properly since that. And I thank God that I ain't stay here, that I can be able to testify to them. So everybody that know about a stroke will know what I'm going through right now, because after I tell Brother Joe, he tell me, no, you got that vertigo so long, too long. And they start to remember what was happening to me all that time. And they said, it have to be a stroke. And they called the doctor, and she tell me, know that a stroke you had, met to the hospital right now. So after I met the hospital, the doctor examined me and thing, tell me it was a stroke. He sent me through the machines and thing, and he tell me then, what part you are destroyed is something that blocking it. So we can't see exactly where it was. But right now, my left side, sometimes I try to let water step. And when I do that, I find out I can't move. And when I hold back on to step, I have to drag my left foot. So I don't know what it is, but I always say God is good. I am worried. No, I don't think about it. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. I don't want to complain, but honestly, since I got baptized, it's like everything I've been going wrong. My brother is in a very desperate situation right now, and if not for brother coming, encouraging me and stuff, I probably would have given up. You know, so I just want to ask everyone to continue to pray that I hold on in Jesus.
Hold on. One more?
Anyone else?
Good afternoon, church. I want to thank the Lord for his many blessings he has bestowed upon me. I want to thank him for giving me a good family where I can rely on, not only my immediate family, but a church family. I also want to thank him for his promises, because during this week I've had a very stressful week, but because of his promises, I'm able to stand and thank him today. So I want to thank the Lord for his many promises, that in everything we do, there is a promise in store that we can hold on to. Help us that we will be faithful so that when he comes, that we all will go home with him.
Amen.
Amen.
Anyone else?
Praise the Lord. Even if you have not stood today and spoken out your testimony, I'm sure that in your heart, you're giving God thanks for his goodness. That was you. Amen.
I'm not here to elaborate, but God has been good to me. I'm done with the work. You know, that's a good feeling, of course. But why I'm standing primarily is to ask you to remember Chris in prayer. You may have observed him go out during the, before the sermon, or just when the sermon was in its early stages, and he should be at the doctor now. He is taken with an excruciating pain in his right arm. And the doctor had told him that the next time it occurs, come right away. He said he had been observing it in and out for the last few weeks. So today it took him very seriously. And I observed his family's countenance changed when he told them. So he is at the doctor, and I will speak with him later this afternoon to find out. But let's ask the Lord to ensure his progress is satisfactory. You want to say something, Ariel?
I'm not sure, but yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
I think it's necessary and to give God thanks for all the, even sometimes when we think our minor blessings, because before him, before his provision, before his protection, you have to ask the question, where will we be? And as I look around this congregation, the young people are not here, but everybody is aging in some way or other, and it seems as though illness follows aging. And as sure as night turns to day, all of us will be having something occurring at some point in time. And we really got to hold on to God and trust Him and pray for whatever we need to make these situations right or to take us through these situations. I don't want to get into the lament because I'll be hearing about sicknesses and what and illnesses. I remember always for almost 5 years now ago when I had my situation with my neck and my spinal cord and how debilitating that was and where it was going. When you get a pronouncement from the doctor, if you don't have something done now, you're going to be paralyzed. And even surgery did not guarantee that you would not be paralyzed. I am thankful to God that I could have gone through that and to be as able as I am now, although I am not fully able. There are some things that I could not have done, like for instance, attempt to move the communion table, which I did today, and the rostrum that I can do now that I certainly could not have done then. And then a couple months ago, I got a scare from a medical test that revealed that I had a very high PSA level. And going through the process to find out what it actually was, to have a retest to find out now that it had not even remained stable, but it had risen significantly in a short space of time. And then to be faced with the possibility or probability that it could have been cancerous, which both doctors seem to suggest that it could be. But there's always power in prayer, and I sincerely believe that asking God to step in and to relieve me from a burden that I may not be able to bear, that He stepped in, and when the results from the biopsy came about, I was cancer-free. And I will say this because this is a subject in terms of prostate cancer that men don't talk about and whatever. And I will say at this point in time, I've become an advocate, a convert, because I've had so many friends, school friends and other friends, who have passed through the process and have not been as lucky as I am. And it is something that keeps recurring and something that needs to be brought to the forefront so that people can get away from their fears and go to get tested early so that it will not become catastrophic. I've heard about two people in last week who died from prostate cancer as well, who probably could have been saved if they had taken action early. So for the many here, I would advocate that we do what is necessary to help us through with the grace of God to avoid something that could be avoided. And I, again, give God thanks for His mercies. And I am confronted with a situation with my wife who is also battling something that we can't definitively find. And I pray that you could continue to pray for us, that an answer could be found, a relief could be had, that you can, you know, reach that degree of normalcy where you can live without wondering what next, wondering, you know, what will happen, and to be living in uncertainty. I'm certain that other people here have other concerns, and but give it all to Jesus. And I hope and pray that we can continue to pray for one another so that God's grace can be available to each and every one of us.
Sister Abby, I visited Max yesterday and he sends his greetings to the church.
Good afternoon, church. I'm taking this opportunity. On behalf of myself and husband, I would like to extend our thanks, great thanks for the prayers, and I want to thank God for the opportunity where I would have encountered caring for a loved one. And I thank God for the opportunity whereby, despite of it would have been a surgery, there were no major accident along the way this far. Max is healing gracefully in the Lord, and I'm grateful for the opportunity where I could have been around to care for him. And I want the church to continue praying for us, and I pray that God will bless Max as he lie there each and every day, and that he will come to a place where he communicate and come closer to God and accept God as his Lord and Savior because of his encounter. And today I would like to take the opportunity to thank God for all the male and the fathers. Today I pray that God will bless you guys and give you a wonderful, well-spent day tomorrow as you celebrate this special day. And those ladies that would have cared for the children without a father as well. And I would like the church to sing me that song, Thanks, Thanks, I Give You Thanks, Lord. Amen.
She wants to sing Thanks, Thanks, I Give You Thanks. But he can't sing. Albert, you know it? Thanks.
Thanks, thanks, I give you thanks for all you have done. I am so blessed, my heart is at rest. Oh God, I give you thanks, 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 thanks. We give you thanks, Lord, for all you have done. We are so blessed, our soul is at rest. Oh Lord, we give you thanks. Oh Lord, we give you thanks.
Amen.
After Sister Abby giving thanks, I couldn't sit down unless I give God thanks for a number of things. As Brother Argyle said, I'm not going to go through any medical history this morning. I just want to thank God for today. Last Sabbath, I was laughing so loudly home that my wife won't know what happened. You know, I was laughing. I felt so good, the best I've felt in a long time. You see, I asked God a few months ago to give me especially Sabbath so you get church and prison. And last Sabbath, I felt so good, I had a laugh. And I said, God, what about another day or two? He gave me 3 more days this week. And I have to be very thankful to God for his goodness. And this week was especially good for me. I mentioned to the church some time ago that my family came up with the idea of starting a educational foundation to assist individuals with their schooling, also other things at the 70 schools, at our schools. And it was getting tremendous difficulty in getting the bank account open. Started from November, trying to get an account open. I never knew it was such a difficult task. But this week I got the good news that is now available. And individuals who are waiting on this to contribute, they're happy. They kept asking me what's happening. It had everything stalled. And I want to thank God for that good news this week as well. And for today. Some time ago when Sister Catherine asked me teaching a lesson, I had to put it off once or twice because I was feeling so weak that I totally couldn't stand up to teach a lesson. And someone suggested you sit down. But I want to thank God that I've not had to sit down. I had to remember that I was before the mic and I had to stay one space stationary I got to my old ways. I thank God for his strength, and today is a beautiful day. And I thank God and praise God today for everything.
Amen. God has always been good. For our closing hymn, we are going to render praise as set out in this verse that alludes to the fact that Christ the Lord is risen today. Let us make sure that the Christ who rose on the Sunday after his resurrection is alive in our hearts. And may we have the melodious strains with our voices accompany them that would almost lift this roof. The hymn 166, Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. Let's have it great. Thank you.
says, or is the cross, the grave, the skies? Not the sequence. You don't get the sky before the cross and the grave. Amen? So as we sojourn here, we know that there are going to be trials, there are going to be temptations, we're going to make a little slip, a little fall sometimes, but when we go down, let us reach up because Christ is already reaching down. Amen? Amen. God is good. Let's bow our heads. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your continuous wonderful blessings towards us. We were privileged today to sit at your feet. Yes, we had the opportunity to assemble fellowship with each other, but we experienced sweet communion with you, and we are grateful. We ask that as, even as we go down, that you continue to be with us. Grant us traveling mercies. Keep our minds fixed upon you. Lord, we know that because we have made ourselves, we have aligned ourselves to you, we know we become instant enemies of the devil. And he's going to be trying, but we have confidence. We rest upon your promises. You are there protecting us, shielding us, preparing us that when you come out, if you call, we will be ready to meet you. We ask your blessings upon the offerings that have been given. We pray that you bless them and that they will go to further the message, not only the spoken word, but to meet and to relieve some trouble somewhere. Lord, let these funds be used the way that you prescribe. May they bring glory to you. May someone be comforted. May there be a witness and a testimony to the rest of us. We thank you. We ask your blessings even as we depart in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you all.
Notify you that next week we'll be having Children's Youth Day. Title of the program is God is in Control, 9:30 next Sabbath. We're inviting, if you have some children in your community, you can bring them over to church next week, Sabbath, you know, and come out and support the event. We're inviting all the parents to come back next week. We're having a very special program, so we invite you to church next week, all right? Blessings, everyone.
Still know you are.
Quietness and trust.